Good afternoon from the Hilltop. Welcome to today's Alumni Career Services webinar sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. I'm Sarah Smith, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and today's webinar, Becoming an Authentic Leader, is presented by a trio of industry experts, Mahan Tavakoli, MBA class of 1993, and Hoya friends Triana Newton and Karen Kimsey-Sward. Before we get started, I'd like to share just a few webinar tips and reminders. First, this webinar is being recorded and it will be made available to all registrants on our Alumni Career Services YouTube channel within 48 hours of today's broadcast. You'll receive a link to the webinar recording in a webinar follow-up email, which will also contain a post-webinar survey for you to take, information on upcoming webinars, and more ways to stay connected with Georgetown Alumni Career Services. A trio of leaders will conduct a Q&A session towards the end of their presentation, and they look forward to hearing from you. Please send in your questions and comments as you have them throughout the webinar using the questions area of the GoToWebinar control panel. And finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the questions area of the GoToWebinar system as well. Without further ado, and so we can get things underway, I'm going to turn everything over to our presenters now so that they can introduce themselves and get our webinar underway. Take it away, y'all.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction, Sarah, and good afternoon, everyone. First of all, happy Chinese New Year, a year of the pig. And Triana, Karen, and I are really excited to be working on this project together, presenting some thoughts on authentic leadership. The three of us have worked together literally on senior leadership teams and on with clients across the globe. So we don't want to tell you too much about ourselves, besides the fact that we are excited to do this for Georgetown, because as I was going through my own MBA program, I remember there was a lot of conversations around the focus on ethics. Some of the students wanted us to focus more on other factors, finance, marketing, to raise the school's standard and ranking. And good for Georgetown for sticking to ethics as a key driver, because Georgetown does what's right rather than what's expedient at the moment. And that's a big part of what authentic leadership is all about.
You know, many of the leaders that we work with realize the importance and the role that authentic leadership plays in building a strong culture. There's just a real focus on that. And we're looking forward to spending the next hour with you, sharing our insights and some of our experiences. And we want to make sure we keep this very interactive. And we're looking forward to gaining your thoughts and engaging with you as well during this hour together.
Exactly. And Mahan mentioned we've worked together over the years, and we're still on our journey as authentic leaders. We're fortunate that we get to work with companies around the globe and help them leverage authenticity to build up their organizational excellence and capabilities. But it is one of those things today you're going to hear us talk a lot about, it being a journey. This is not something that you just arrive at. So we're excited to share that with you and get your insights as well, and all of us continue on this path of becoming more authentic leaders. So I guess we want to talk about what we're going to do today, but you don't want to see us for the rest of this webinar, or I don't want to see Mahan anymore. So we're going to take our cameras off so you can actually concentrate on the entire session. So today we really want to be able to focus on and take us really from the, you know, the what it is, obviously, and have a broad agreement on what authentic leadership is, all the way through, you know, what is that journey look like? What is the path, your progression? What are the key drivers that really, you know, are instrumental in becoming an authentic leader? And also, I hope by the end of the session that we're really making the case for what authentic leadership can do, not only individually, but collectively for our teams and for our organizations, because there are some tangible benefits to authentic leadership and building that kind of culture in our organizations. And ultimately, at the end of the session, we hope that you know, we're also going to invite you to our authenticity challenge. So Karen will be with you at the end of the session for that. So one of the things we're going to ask you today as you go through a webinar, we have 1 hour, and obviously there's a lot to this topic. Each one of these points could probably be a webinar in itself. But we're going to ask you not to do what we've experienced before, which is we call checking all the boxes. You know, okay, here's all the things I've got to do to be an authentic leader. You know, here's all these drivers they talked about today. And we really want everybody to look at this from where you are on your journey as an authentic leader, and be able to maybe pick up some insights or some sharing from others in the session today as we go through. We were actually consulting with a company that was going through a leadership transition, and the new leader arrived. He was talking a great story, the potential, you know, how they could unite on this mission, this purpose. He painted a great future ahead, and the team, we could see the team was pretty excited. You know, for the team, he was checking all the boxes, you know, great potential things. We were energized, they were excited. And the guy was, he was pretty good at the front of the room, and he used a lot of emotional power when he was talking. He'd even sometimes pause and sort of get choked up, and people would, you know, people would really respond to that and think how powerful that was. And he often described himself as an authentic leader. He made that point a number of times. And again, for the team, that was checking all the boxes. We noticed something early on. When he was first engaging with the team, when he wasn't presenting, we noticed that he was off on his own, doing his own thing. And it wasn't until one of the team members would engage with him that he would actually, you know, sort of get back to talking about his message and his inspirational presentation. And we thought that might have been a one-off. And then we saw another event where his team was actually sitting down after a meeting, reflecting on the day. He walked right by them. And it wasn't until one of them actually invited him over. And you could tell it was an awkward situation because it was not what he planned to do. But we saw this sort of disconnect from what was at the front of the room to what was the behaviors that we saw offline. Fast forward a couple of weeks later to the first, what we'll call it, a burst of anger in a team meeting. And pretty soon we now had, you know, we had people coming to us going like, what's going on? This guy is actually yelling at us. Like we were energized. We were excited. Like, what's happening? And, you know, cause this guy had for them checked all the boxes. One of the things that really came through, you know, because this team's trajectory unraveled pretty quickly, the engagement scores plummeted. They really plummeted. Revenue started to decrease. Long-term people turned over. And ultimately, you know, the team was on a not good, the organization itself was not on a good trajectory. Something definitely had to change. The core piece there was this guy, the leader, he was doing authenticity. He wasn't being an authentic leader. You notice our title today, becoming an authentic leader. He was doing the checklist. This was not part of who he was in his authentic self. And I think we really can tell the difference. So one of those first things as we consider authenticity, it is making sure our path includes us being authentic, not just doing it because we're told it's the right thing to do. Now, we need some kind of working definition. We're not going to trot out the Webster's Dictionary version here and say this is what authenticity is. I think authenticity, from our experience, really resides in the behaviors and the characteristics and the experiences that we've all had that have us saying, hey, that person is authentic. So I'm going to ask you to warm up your fingers here for the chat function. And the question on the table is, thinking about a person that you consider to be authentic, could be at work, could be in your social circle, could be family members, you know, it doesn't matter the context, but there's something that they do or they say or they behave in a certain way that has you perceive them to be authentic. And I'm just going to ask you guys to start blowing up the chat function here. What is it that those people do that makes you consider them authentic? So I'll give everybody a moment to make sure that they can exercise that chat function and get the ideas flowing at this point. Those are coming on board. Okay, Sarah, you got the sound piece working for somebody, obviously?
Yep.
Great. So I noticed everybody's reflecting on this at this point and making sure they've... So I've got somebody said, authentic people look you in the eye, physical contact. Yeah, there is that proximity. Comfortable in their own skin. You can tell that there's they are relaxed and there's a confidence there. Empathetic, absolutely. Mahan, Karen, what are you seeing?
Tree, a lot of times the way people listen to us in the moment has a big, lets us know whether they're being authentic or not. I've heard a couple of times over the past week about people that have been even experiencing in the workplace health issues. And everyone does the check the box of asking them, how are you doing? But the how are you doing is a check-in it's sort of a formality rather than an authentic desire to get to know how the other person is doing.
Yeah, no, you're right. You can see through a lot of the comments, you know, honest communication, listening, follow through, listening intently, expressing vulnerability. Actually, that's great. We're going to come back to that one. Karen, what are you seeing?
Well, you know, I think transparent. And it's, it seems like that's sometimes a buzzword with leaders. Oh, I'm going to be transparent, right? And they'll talk about it. Again, it's the being versus doing. And then everybody, oh, great, they're going to be transparent. But then certain key things happen, you know, on a day-to-day basis. And then people realize they're not as transparent as they said. So it can happen. So
great. All right. Karen, over to you.
Okay. When we ask other leaders, because when we go in and we work with other leaders and we ask them kind of this question, here are some of the words that we hear. You know, I mentioned, we all mentioned different ones. We talk about transparency. We talk about consideration. You can see from a lot of these comments, they're mirrored in some of the points that we were making. And although there's broad agreement, each one of us is going to have our own personal definition, as Triana said, and a lot of it is based on what we've experienced and it's what's important to us on how we would show up as an authentic leader. I think the real key thing here is, and this is what we always talk when we're talking with leaders and we say, you know, really what's important is it's how you want to show up. It's what's important to you. You know, keeping in mind, it's not a checklist. It's not a one size fits all. It's about uniquely you. And this is like one of my favorite quotes, because it's like, be you, right? Be you, and that's a really important thing. As we take a look at the, we really believe in being you. It really does start with you and yourself, and that it's about a journey and it's a progression of being an authentic leader. And so, as I mentioned, it starts with self. And then it's really the relationship with others and then with the team. This really isn't, it's not binary. It's you don't all of a sudden arrive at authentic. It's really about a continuum. And we really all fall on this continuum. We can be more authentic or we can be less authentic. It is where you are, and it's not whether or not you are authentic, which is why working on yourself is one of the most critical aspects of authentic leadership. So let's start talking about and taking a look at some of the drivers of self.
Yeah, so becoming a more authentic leader first and foremost means we have to challenge our self-perceptions. And after that, then we can embrace a growth mindset. Now, there's a cognitive bias called the Dunning-Kruger effect. And I'm sure no one on this webinar has that. Otherwise, you wouldn't have it's an issue you're dealing with, otherwise you wouldn't have joined the webinar. But in essence, Dunning-Kruger, it's a cognitive bias that people that are not as capable mistakenly see themselves as being more capable than they are. And I'm sure all of us know a lot of people like this around. But the most authentic leaders are people that constantly challenge their blind spots. I have to tell you, I had a pretty brutal experience of this myself. I don't necessarily always recommend 360s. It's a great tool, but can also be pretty harmful if not used well. A few years back, I went through a 360 with my team. And being that I've talked about leadership and I've done leadership for a long time, I thought the results would come back great. And actually, some of the results were good, except one part. I had been rated low on a question like creating a trusting environment. And wow, that was an absolute blindside for me. And the first thing they say when you experience something like this, you go through DARA, denial, anger, rationalization, finally acceptance. Well, I skipped the denial part and went right to anger. Wanted to pull my team into a room and say, hey, you know what? If you can't trust me, that says something about you. I'm working hard. I'm doing all that I can, so on and so forth. To make a long story short, it took a while and it took some guidance to realize that it doesn't matter if I think I'm trustworthy or not. That's not what leadership is about. It's partly how other people see me. And for me to be able to reduce my blind spots, I need to become more open to that external feedback. So part of what we've seen is leaders that are more authentic leaders realize that they have blind spots, realize that the higher up we move in our organizations, the more likely people are to somewhat censor what they tell us. So they actively work to encourage feedback in order to reduce those blind spots. Now, one of the people that talks about this a lot is, I would highly recommend Daniel Kahneman's work. Obviously, he is the first psychologist to win a Nobel Prize for economics. And he wrote Thinking Fast and Slow, probably one of the best decision makers and one of the best thinkers there could be, because that's what he studies. And Kahneman says your best advisor is someone that likes you a lot. There has to be that like and trusting relationship, but doesn't care about your feelings. And that is so true in terms of the most authentic leaders. We were fortunate to work for a COO of an organization that we actually reported to him. To people on the outside, he seemed very brutal because the feedback he gave was really harsh. But to us, we absolutely adored him because he had the kind of relationship to give us that feedback. And we knew he gave us that feedback because he cared deeply about us. So with those couple of things in mind, just curious, we would love to take a quick poll of you all. Tell us, what percent of people do you think are truly self-aware? So you can go ahead and mark it and we'll see the poll results. Is it 0 to 25%, so very small percentage of people, 26 to 50%, 51 to 75%, 76 to 100%? We would love to get some of your thoughts. Go ahead and vote for one of those. What percentage of people do you think in organizations are truly self-aware?
We got lots of responses coming in. The bars are moving quite quickly. You might, we'll give it a moment as people are considering this.
Fantastic. And obviously this is always when we're talking about other people, because I'm sure all of us on this webinar are truly self-aware. But so what percentage of people are truly self-aware? Just another couple of seconds for any of the last votes.
86 people have voted. We want to go for those last 14. There you go.
Let's go. All right. Retreat.
So we're going to collect the, and should be sharing now. So it should be coming up on everybody's screen.
Fantastic. 0 to 25%, 48% of you, 26 to 50%, 42%. So the vast majority of you see that other people are not very self-aware. Now, you know, one of the interesting things is this could be like a driving analogy, in that whoever you ask how good of a driver they are, we are all much better than average, which is not really possible. But so we see other people as being worse than average. This is pretty accurate, though. There's Dr. Tasha Urich has done some studying around this. She's author of Insight, one of the most watched TED Talks. And her research shows somewhere around 10 to 15% of people actually are truly self-aware. Which means what? Which means in greatest likelihood, we all could also use greater self-awareness to our advantage. It would help us become a lot more authentic. So become more self-aware. And I love what she jokes about. She says, if you think about it, on an average day, about 80% of us are lying to ourselves about lying to ourselves, right? So if you take nothing else from this, is that in greatest likelihood, as self-aware as we think we are, we all have blind spots. And by reducing those blind spots, we can become more authentic leaders.
So the fact that I think the group, a majority of the group actually felt that lower percentile was is what percentage people were self-aware, does speak to the fact that there's obviously a lot of room for us to expand that. So that first part is definitely challenging that self-perception aggressively and taking that feedback in a way that you can actually, it's going to be productive. And then what we want to do is marry it with a growth mindset. And many of you have probably seen Carol Dweck's work on growth mindset, first started in education and then has really manifested itself into the business world. And the premise in her book, Mindset, really comes around this difference in a fixed mindset and a growth mindset, and a growth mindset with a belief that you can change your talents, your intelligence, your abilities over a fixed mindset, which doesn't, you know, believe that's possible. She's also talking now about a mixed mindset, which is somewhere in between. But we really feel that from an authentic leader's point of view, if we're going to really challenge our self-perceptions, then we're going to have to be ready to take this next step, which is being willing to try and being, you know, really considerate about the fact that we can improve, we can make changes. So it is that fundamental belief. I was a corporate trainer for a number of years, and I, you know, at the time, people might have considered that I was kind of at the top of my game, or at least that's what people told me. And probably at that stage of my life, I was believing too much of that. And I really got a good kick in the butt on that because I really hadn't, I sort of thought I had arrived, I think. And then I went to do my commercial pilot's license. And for those of you, if I've got any pilots or people who have ever done flight training on the, you'll know that that's not what I'd call a nurturing learning environment. So when you make a mistake, you're called out on it, and some pretty colorful language is used to tell you screwed up. So I was back being a student, and that really rocketed me back to, first of all, a moment where you're really questioning, whether I could change and grow, because this was going to be a leap in my competencies as a pilot. But I had those moments where I had to get back and recognize that I had to make that switch, and I most importantly had to make that switch as a trainer, so that I was more respectful and mindful of the learning process that people were going through, because I had really lost touch with that. So one of the growth mindset applies to us individually, but it also really does apply to us in teams and organizationally. And if you've read Mindset, Carol Dweck's book, you'll see some of the research and studies they've done about how growth mindset companies are outperforming fixed mindset companies. All the usual things, revenue and everything else, but reputational excellence, operational excellence, so many ways, competitiveness and agility, that this is powering these organizations. So there's some, again, tangible benefits to this. But even before Carol Dweck's good work was out there, I do believe that there's somebody who had some insights into growth mindset early on, Yoda. So let's hear what he had to say about growth mindset. So unlearn what you have learned. Good reminder to all of us, because in some cases maybe there's elements, as we talked today on authenticity, that we maybe feel that don't resonate for us, and we may have to explore their value to us. But I do like the try not, just do. And of course we've seen that manifest itself, and there's some good sporting analogies out there. But I think it really embodies that critical piece of embracing a growth mindset, which starts at the core of us being willing and having a belief that we can change. And if that's not something that our internal tape is saying, then we need to surround ourselves with people, not who are going to just give us lavish praise and who are going to praise us unnecessarily, but those who can give us the feedback that's necessary for us to tap into that belief again and know that we can shift and change. So that's a critical piece of marrying that in growth mindset with challenging our self-perception. Karen mentioned this is a progression, right, earlier on, but really, again, we're that self piece. If we don't have that locked in, if we're not feeling that, you know, if we're not aware of those blind spots, challenging those self-perceptions, understanding where we're not perceived as authentic or delivering and behaving in that way, then there's no way for us to be able to really transition to the work that we do in building authentic relationships and building our team. So this we often refer to as the base. Karen?
As Triana said, it is a progression, and we just spent a lot of some time talking about self. Now let's take a look at some of the key drivers in really developing more authentic relationships with others. And as you can see, we have a few here, and we're going to start, let's just start with trust, which is a key one. You know, many times when leaders discuss trust, they're thinking about how they show up. How trustworthy are they? And you know, we all know trustworthiness is such an important part of being an authentic leader, and it's really important part of developing self and making sure that we're modeling trust in every interaction, a key piece. But another layer to trust is when developing relationships with others and how we trust others. And it's really taking a look at it through that lens. You know, many times, you know, I hear leaders say, they have to earn the right or earn trust. They have to earn the trust from me before I'm going to be giving them anything. And really, we've been taught that people must earn trust, but when in fact, it's really something we grant to others. When I think about granted versus earned trust, I always think about the analogy of driving. Mahan was mentioned driving before, and there are always such great analogies, and it's about driving on the road. And you know, when I'm driving on the road, I'm granting trust. The other person driving, that they're going to stop at that. They're going to stop at that red light. And if I didn't grant the trust, and every time I came up to a green light, and if I saw, and I had to stop and say, okay, is this other person, are they going to stop? Are they not going to stop? Right? Then what happens is things become very chaotic and they come to a grinding halt. So we really have to give a certain level of granted trust in order to really operate in society. So then we take a look at that in business and how that shows up in business. And one of the things that we've all found out is that the most effective leaders are the ones that really start with granted trust first, rather than being stingy with their trusting. And, you know, a great example of this is a few years ago, I was brought into a company to help them get back on track. They were really, really struggling and had a 2 or 3 year stint where their numbers, their growth was not there. And their chief of salesperson was abruptly fired due to this lack of results. So as I started getting in there and working with the team, it was so clear to me that the former chief of sales didn't grant any trust with his team. Not one person, not even the seasoned people. It was amazing. He tracked every movement they made. He had to look at every proposal. He insisted he go on every sales call. And we went on the sales call. He ended up dominating the conversation, wouldn't let the other people talk. He did not overtly tell them he didn't trust them, but obviously he did so by his actions. So as a result of him not trusting them, you know, what happens is then they don't trust him. And so there's lack of trust on both sides. And then what happens is it causes a very toxic and low performing environment, which kind of led them to be where they were with their results. So another key driver in developing more authentic relationships is really how we value others and how we value people. It's really critical to value the human and not the results they produce or the function they serve. And I know for people, a lot of us that are very type A, a lot of times we get caught up in the results. But it really is looking at people as humans. We believe in the platinum rule of doing unto others as they want done to them. Valuing the person based on what they value. What's important to them? So many times I think leaders think they're showing employees that they value them based on what they think is important. And then they get feedback from their employees that they don't feel valued. This has happened to me multiple times. I think where it's that self-awareness isn't there. And I was recently working with the CFO, who kind of prided himself that he kept in touch with his people and he felt very connected. But he kept getting feedback from his direct reports that they didn't feel like he valued them. And he heard this multiple times. He was pretty frustrated. He goes, wait a minute, what's wrong here? You know, the pay is great. They seem to like their jobs. We're doing well. I give them some feedback and coaching. So when I went and interviewed and talked with his employees, they talked about the number of times that he would, just in casual conversation, that he would say, you know, how's your weekend? But it wasn't like, really, how's your weekend? It was almost like, how's your weekend? As Triana said, kind of checking the box. And what happened is halfway through them telling him about the weekend, half the time he'd lose eye contact, he'd be looking around. Sometimes he would kind of find somebody else and kind of abruptly leave and start a conversation with them. So they felt very, very devalued. And, you know, on the contrary, there are many times I know that I felt very valued. And when that happens, it feels pretty great. Where, you know, it's like, you know, different leaders in my career where I felt very, very valued in different situations. And so really wanted to ask you, what have other people done for you that have truly made you feel valued? So if you could type that in the chat box, that would be great. We'd love to hear from you.
And as people are typing that in, Karen, Ray also asked a great question. We're going to have a time for question and answers later on, but I wanted to address this question as people are thinking about what have other people done that have truly made you feel valued. His question in essence is, can we actually make other people more self-aware? And it's a very relevant question because in many instances, people's own confirmation bias kicks in. And the more we push, the more they start reinforcing their own self-beliefs, which is why to us, authentic leadership is a lot more about how we behave, the standards we set for ourselves, then for the team, as opposed to how we push other people to uncover their blind spots. When people are not willing and open to it, it's very hard, which is why the best leaders are ones that set the example rather than trying to make other people become self-aware. So to Karen's question, it's important to also do what makes people feel valued. So what have people done to help you feel valued? Type in the chat box. Let us know if there is something people have done that has made you feel valued. So whether
things like, you know, Susan made a comment about invited to increase participation. TJ said immediate and meaningful feedback. Just something as simple as saying thank you for something specific you did. You know, it is, I get Megan's point, or I hope I pronounced that correctly. There was a leader we encountered one time. He said, thank you for all that you do. And you could tell, that it was just sort of a check the boxes type of exercise. So, you know, you really felt valued when somebody could be specific. So that's great. And then Mahan, you had one.
Yeah, I wanted to reemphasize with that point, Tree, is all of these things have more to do with our behaviors and the standard we set for other people.
Absolutely. So Carolyn said, my boss used to push me to think outside of the box. You know, and again, that's wanting your contribution and valuing your contribution. Cares about you personally, Emmer's point about that.
As simple as Tree, one of the organizations that I'm working with now is having an issue with turnover, which is causing other people in the organization to feel an additional strain and stress. There is a little frustration that some of the senior leadership in the organization doesn't acknowledge that, doesn't come and say, well, you know what? We realize this is adding more stress on you. Thank you for pulling your weight. So sometimes it's just helping people feel valued is stating the obvious, but it makes a big difference.
Absolutely. And it's you're right. And I think it's important for leaders to take time to connect with others. right? That's it. It's stopping. It's not like some and making it some big thing, right? It's just about, okay, let me just take a few minutes. Let me better understand people and kind of what makes them feel valued.
Yeah, so part of it is helping people feel valued. Yeah. Another critical factor is showing and inviting vulnerability. Now, this is really hard for a lot of us, for a lot of leaders, because we want to come across as being perfect, knowing it all, doing things properly. We've almost been trained into that. But that actually is not the way of the authentic leader. Another one of the interesting cognitive biases and research is around what's called the pratfall effect. And pratfall effect is when someone is competent, this is not talking about someone who is consistently underperforming, not doing things well. When someone is perceived as being competent, if they make a mistake, if there is an issue, people tend to like them more. And there have been lots of studies around this, even with people making presentations where they have everything in a presentation, right? Someone that is seen as competent, when they make a mistake, the person that made the mistake is seen as more likable. So I don't know how many of you are history buffs or not. Typically, when I ask a group of people that have studied history or like history about when John Kennedy was at his most popular, so when his popularity spiked, very few people, if any, guess John Kennedy was at one of the highest levels of popularity after Bay of Pigs. Now, if anyone has heard the name Bay of Pigs, that was probably one of the biggest disappointments, misadventures. Whoever was at fault, it was on John Kennedy's time when US tried to invade Cuba, and it was an absolute mess. Now, John Kennedy, who had been seen as this good-looking guy with the perfect family, had everything right, had something go wrong. He did step up and own up to it, but that shot up his popularity. So the pratfall effect, in essence, means owning up to our mistakes and also being willing to show vulnerability allows people to relate more to us as human beings. And this doesn't mean necessarily doing things by to just show people we make mistakes. It doesn't mean putting things in presentations that don't go well intentionally. That's not being authentic. It means showing people who we truly are allows them to connect with us more. Showing people what helps us make decisions the way we do, what priorities we have, helps them connect with us more. One of the most fascinating examples to me is Microsoft, which this is a org chart that Manu Cornett had drawn from Microsoft under Ballmer. And in essence, if you see it, it's a bunch of department heads and everyone's pointing a gun at everyone. And this continues into entire Microsoft because that is what the culture of Microsoft was about. They had the wrong culture and wrong strategy. When they selected a new CEO, he decided to prioritize culture above strategy. Now, to me, Satya Nadella is a fascinating case study, smart guy, really humble, and he prioritized culture first and foremost because he knew if he wanted to change Microsoft's strategy after taking over at 2014, all those guns that were pointed at each other would have caused him to fail. So Nadella talks about, if you have read his book, Hit Refresh, or have ever seen him talk, he talks about his son, Zane. Actually, his son experienced asphyxiation during pregnancy while his wife was pregnant and has been severely disabled as a result. Nadella doesn't tell this story for people to connect with him. If you ever see Nadella read anything about him, he tells the story because when this happened to him, the first things that went through his mind were, why me? Why us? What have I done to deserve this? But fast forward, his son Zane has been one of the biggest gifts in life to Nadella because his son has taught him empathy, which is why Nadella embraces empathy and has that as one of the core values of how he behaves as the CEO of Microsoft with everyone in that organization. So this is authenticity at its core because it's Nadella at his core. Again, I don't want to minimize what he has done at Microsoft that is now has surpassed Apple as the most valuable company in the world, the strategy of moving to the cloud. But guess what? None of those things would have happened if Nadella was not willing to change the culture of Microsoft. And one of the key ways he changed the culture at Microsoft was to show that he is a vulnerable leader, show that he prioritizes empathy and a growth mindset, and then move the organization from there on. One of the questions a lot of times when we talk about showing vulnerability, people ask us is, okay, what's the level of appropriate level of vulnerability to show, right? We're at work after all. I wish we had like a ruler or a metric to give you. There isn't one, right? Each person has to determine for him or herself what's the appropriate level of vulnerability. But there are two critical things to keep in mind. Number one, vast majority of leaders, Tree is in Canada, has traveled the entire globe. Karen is in Chicago, same thing. I'm in DC, same thing. We've worked with leaders across the globe, and guess what? The vast majority of them are on the side of showing too little vulnerability and humanity. So you know what? In greatest likelihood, you are not going to get in trouble for showing more vulnerability. And the second thing to keep in mind is that the leader sets the standard. The leader sets a standard. Whether you're a leader of a team of three or a leader of, like Nadella, of an organization of 130,000, how much vulnerability you show, how much authenticness you show, sets the standard for the others. It's not something you can push on them. It's something you can show and exhibit. That's then what allows other people to be the true human beings they are and become authentic.
So, ourselves, obviously, you know, we were talking about the first pieces in terms of challenging self-perception and growth mindset as it applied to us. And we had a question come in saying, you know, it's almost sounding like it's the perception of somebody being authentic that makes them authentic. And in some cases, that's going to be true, because when we talk about leaders, most of what we do is reflected by others, the relationships that we have, the working relationships we have, and the teams that we lead or the organizations we lead. So in some cases, after our personal work is done, yes, in many cases, we are relying on those perceptions to tell us, are we resonating as authentic? We'll come back to some more of those questions as we go forward. So, you know, the self, we are focusing on our foundation with others. It is granting trust rather than waiting for trust to be earned. It's valuing the person in the way they, in a way that matters to them. And we had some great examples and I'm sorry, we refer to it as chat. We've been working on Zoom too much lately in the question section. And we heard everything from, you know, that genuine interest that somebody paid attention to or noticing certain things, or just even the simple feedback or appreciation of specific things done. Taking an interest involving somebody, asking for greater contributions, showed that the leader was looking at that person being valued in a way that was important for them. We talked about showing and inviting vulnerability, being able to give by showing vulnerability, giving insights to people of who we are and what our DNA is, but also inviting them and giving them permission and a platform to be able to join us in that. Thus, we could have a more authentic working relationship. We're going to transition that because now, you know, as that evolves, really we want to be able to take that to our team, our department, our organization, whatever your context is. So we're going to look at those drivers that are really applicable to building an authentic team. And really it comes down to uniting our around a team's why, and we'll talk about that in a minute, and creating the right environment. And when I talk about uniting around a team's why, I have some biases, and don't blow up the question function yet. I have some big biases around vision and mission. Some organizations it works very well, and some it's on the wall and it has no meaning or power to the organization. So when we talk about uniting around a team's why, we're talking about something. It could be organizational, it could be your department, could be your team, but it's for them that is a purpose that they can emotionally connect to. I mean, Simon Sinek brought us to this, you know, sort of elevated this thought about the why, and but it is also a why. That why is a purpose that people can emotionally connect to, not just intellectually connect to. This is a hearts and a minds exercise, let's call it. We were actually doing some work with an organization, and their department was the department that we were working with was particularly involved in product development and the delivery of what the organization did. And this company had been through, well, I guess this particular department had been without a leader for almost a year as they were trying to make a leadership transition. And that almost compounded the situation. These guys were geographically separate from the parent company and location, and there was a lot of concerns about their contributions and their value, and people were even questioning if we had, you know, people in the right seats, apparently was, you know, some of the conversations. So one of the first things, of course, we had to do was really be able to unite this team and regroup and allow this the new leaders coming in to be able to foster a new future. So at the first kickoff meeting, we actually had each team member talk about their why. You know, why were they with this organization? Why were they doing what they were doing? Why were they with this team? What's had them stick around in an environment that had been pretty volatile and in some kind of, you know, in some cases quite demotivating? And it was really clear this team wanted to serve. Like, that was their thing. They wanted to be valued. They wanted to be part of something. They wanted to be a change agent for the company. So, you know, it was really cool to hear that level of input from this group. So they were looking for that channel. And there was this moment, there was a speaker at the session, they had their presentation, and at the end of their presentation, this slide went up. And I know for some people this might be on the edge, you know, a shift happens, but the moment that slide went up, it was like the aha moment, and everybody said, that's what we're going to be. We want to lead change in the organization. We want to be the catalyst. We want to be the ones that bring positive change to the company. This turned into kind of like their kryptonite. So it showed up. They had t-shirts. They had taglines everywhere around the office. It was on their signatures. It was in their language when they were talking to each other. They had just done something to help a customer, and they get off the phone and they said, and that's how shift happens. And it became part of their working culture. And they went on to actually power amazing and radical changes in that organization. And to see that go from, you know, from the very beginning to the end showed the power of uniting around a why that people can emotionally connect to. And the key there is that emotional connection. It's both that hearts and minds. Now, you've probably seen this, or maybe you've done it yourself and you've seen the impact when that call it compass point north has such a compelling force for everybody that it becomes something that they're unified around. Maybe you've seen that. Let's open up the question boxes now. What have you seen leaders do to emotionally connect people to a purpose? Not just the vision, you know, the vision mission thing, but emotionally connect to a person, to a purpose, I'm sorry. So I'll give a moment for people to collect your thoughts as that's coming in. Anybody's welcome to grab that shift happens visual because I like it. There's a lot of different applications for it. And obviously it's now been put out there in the latest, greatest innovation slides too. They're calling that shift happens too. We'll give everybody a moment to come through. I have people typing. I have somebody clicking. Good. So we're seeing things like, again, inviting people into a cause, asking them what cause they want to be involved in. Franca said, asking very probing questions, the deep questions, helping sort of uncover the why or the mission or what's going to be motivating for people. That's definitely part of that. We also, you can see it's also that individual recognition of people, but being able to galvanize around something for the team. Yeah, this organization we were talking about, they had a vision and a mission and they were fine, but this team needed their purpose. You do annuals and have ongoing conversations as to the why. Love that. Race comment makes it a living part of the culture that we're having that ongoing conversation about this. Absolutely.
And Tree, one of the important things to keep in mind here is that it's not a lot of times when people talk about the why, they think about the organization, because the examples they hear are of Apple or whatever other organization. Those are examples we hear because everyone knows those companies. But the most effective teams, even if it's a team of two or three, I'm right now working with a small IT team within a small SaaS company, software as a service provider. And the IT team is looking at ways they can connect with each other to the IT team's purpose within that small organization's mandate. So the point is not these large, grand organizations coming up with a why. Every group, every team can have a why, but the important thing, again, it's what people can rally around and create together rather than is handed down from the team leader or someone else.
Right. Amir said, standing up for a cause or something you believe in, it should have that same level of emotional power. And it is that powerful emotional connection. But we also want to marry it. Part of that is embedded in the kind of environment that you create.
Yeah. So the other factor is this critical environment. And there are two aspects to that. One of them is psychological safety. The other one is radical candor. Now, psychological safety, Amy Edmondson, Harvard Business School, has done a lot of research around this. And in essence, it means a culture of respect and trust where people feel open to share their opinions and ideas, raise concerns with the organization. And Google actually a couple of years ago spent literally 2 years studying 180 teams in a project called Project Aristotle, because they wanted to see what makes teams successful. So they had, obviously Google has a lot of bright people, but they had some teams with all A players. They had other teams with a great team leader. They looked at all the different varieties of teams. And the most critical factor they came up with was psychological safety in the team, which is that openness and willingness for members of the team to, in essence, stick their neck out without having it get cut off, right? So creating a psychological safe environment is important. There are lots of examples. It's part of how Pixar comes up with such creative storytelling. In most instances, it's done as a part of their brain trust system, which also embraces psychological safety. But with psychological safety, then comes radical candor. See, psychological safety is important because a lot of organizations, a lot of CEOs, team leaders are used to these stretch goals. They love setting goals to transform the world based on what our organization is going to do or based on what our team is going to do. That's great. Be a leader. Set transformative goals, but without psychological safety, the team can get in trouble. And there are lots of examples from the Wells Fargos of the world to Volkswagen. The CEO Martin Winterkorn, he had what could sound like a noble goal, right? Have a diesel car meet California's emission standards. We are going to be the first car company to do that. What an amazing, great thing. That's a stretch goal, but guess what? There was no psychological safety in the organization, no willingness and openness for feedback and pushback. And his famous motto was, I'm not going to take no for an answer. And all of you on the call know what ended up happening. They ended up cheating the system rather than coming up with a way to do it, because there wasn't the kind of safety that goes along with that stretch goal for people to provide feedback. Now, psychological safety isn't lowering your standards, feeling comfortable, being nice and agreeable, or just giving praise. It's the willingness and ability for people to give feedback to the system and have that radical candor that Kim Scott talks about. A great example of this is Ray Dalio. He is the founder of Bridgewater Associates, arguably one of the most successful hedge funds in the world, manages over $160 billion, wrote the book Principles. Ray Dalio talks about radical candor, but it's not for the people on the team only. It's about Ray Dalio. He solicits and gets some pretty brutal feedback from his team members. And you can actually see some of the comments they have made. They associate their names with it. So keep in mind, when you hear radical candor, I've seen some leaders talk about radical candor as if it's something their team needs to be willing to accept. Yes, but as with anything else having to do with authentic leadership, it first starts with you.
And the progression, you know, as we've transitioned, you know, we had an hour today, we're fighting the clock a little bit. There was a, you know, if you look at each one of those drivers, you could expand that out into a whole webinar for each one of those topics. But hopefully we've really driven home the point that, you know, that starting with ourselves and us being an authentic person will allow us to build more authentic relationships and then eventually be able to cascade that to our teams, our department, our organization, whichever context you're in. In a moment, we're going to move to questions because we want to make sure that there's some time left for questions. We're changing the pattern a little bit. We are going to do our authenticity challenge right after our questions. So we're going to ask you to hang on for questions. There's been some great input coming in today. So the question box is open. Go ahead and make sure you can put your questions in. Carolyn was asking, hope this is recorded. It is recorded, and Sarah and team from Georgetown will be sending out the link so everybody will have this to go back and be able to touch base with as they need. Who has the first question? We'll make sure we'll get that covered off. I'm just giving people an opportunity to chat in.
And as they're doing that, Tree, as you mentioned, our contact information is, Sarah sends that out. Feel free to follow up with us because we are, as she said, on this journey ourselves and we are advocates of it. More than happy to support you whenever, however possible.
So Jeff made a comment. He said his question was, when has one been too vulnerable as a leader and what should one avoid in this area? That one's always a loaded question. Karen, you wanna tackle that one to start? Give you a moment to unmute.
Yeah, I'll jump sure, in.
I'm having trouble with my audio, thank you.
I think one of the ways I recommend to people is that if your vulnerability has contributed to you becoming who you are, therefore impacts your decision making, impacts your values, impacts your priorities, then it's a relevant vulnerability to talk about. So back to the Nadella example, he is a very empathetic person. He explains why. He prizes that, he explains why. So it's not vulnerability just for the sake of vulnerability. It contributes to what he values.
That's a good way to express that. Our final question, because I know we're tight for time, is just, you know, somebody said they're on the authenticity journey themselves. How do they parlay that to the team? And there's, you know, obviously many, many ways to do this. I'm not trying to sound self-serving, but actually just sharing this webinar with your team, or even starting off on one of the topics and being able to share one of the stories and use that as a basis to start the conversation. I mean, it really is just even starting this conversation and allowing it to start to be entered into the environment, and ultimately us modeling that for people is a great place to start. So that was our final question, and Karen, over to you.
Sounds good. No, I think I'm back. Sorry. Basically, you know, Dr. Gail Matthews, a psychology professor at the Dominican University in California, recently studied the science of goal setting. And she found that you become 42% more likely to achieve your goals simply by writing them down. How about that? So as you reflect on kind of what we've discussed today, kind of take a minute and write one thing down that you're going to do to become a more authentic leader as a result of the webinar.
Yeah, and as people are doing that, Karen, it reminds me, one of the most prized gifts I ever got was as a master trainer, someone gave me a copy of Velveteen Rabbit. Now, the first few years of life, I didn't grow up here, so I had never read Velveteen Rabbit. And at first, I thought it was a gag gift, giving me a kid's book. But any of you that have read it, it is such a magnificently beautiful story of becoming authentic through showing vulnerability. And part of what the skin horse says to the little rabbit is that real isn't something you are, it's something you become. So we hope this has been a conversation to help you think through how you can, along with us, all become more authentic. Sarah, thank you, and back over to you.
Thank you so, so much, all three of you. This has been so fantastic. I'm giving you a round of applause on my end. I hope everyone else is as well. This has been wonderful hearing from you all. You've gotten many, as I'm sure you can see, thank yous and great presentations. So awesome. To those of you who have joined us today, thank you so much for being here. This recording will go up on our Alumni Career Services YouTube channel, and I'll send out a follow-up email with information on how to contact our presenters today and continue the discussion with them, as well as how to see the recorded webinar. So I encourage you to follow up with all of our presenters for further conversations. This is just the tip of the iceberg here today. Again, thanks to everyone for joining us. I'll wish you all a wonderful rest of your day, and we'll leave it there. Hoya Saksa.